The next item of business is First Minister's questions, and at question number one I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Michael Matheson ran up an £11,000 bill on his iPad and claimed the costs from the taxpayer. It was over the Christmas break, and £7,300 of that bill covered a single day, which was a public holiday. To put that into context, to run up those charges, he would have needed to have sent 8,000 emails in that one day. That's an email written and sent every 10 seconds continuously for 24 hours. All this while the Health Secretary was in Morocco on holiday. Does the First Minister really believe that Michael Matheson ran up all these costs on parliamentary business? Yes or no?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, there is clearly more to say on this issue, and that's why Michael Matheson has agreed to make, with the agreement of Parliament, to make a personal statement later today. I have no intention of preempting that statement. He will lay out in full detail what has happened in relation to the use of his iPad. He has, of course, Michael has agreed to pay back the full amount. He has admitted to an honest mistake that has been made. And, of course, he will elaborate on that and certainly reflect on that.
Let us hear the First Minister.
Officer, I do understand in our politics the very first place we all go to is to think the very worst of each other. And, Presiding Officer, I hold my hands up. I've often done that myself and been guilty of it too. But honest mistakes do happen. Michael has been a member of this Parliament since its inception. All of us who have worked with him know that he is a man of honesty and indeed of integrity. So instead of rushing to besmirch each other's character, perhaps our politics would be a little better if we gave each other the benefit of the doubt. Michael will lay out in full what has happened in relation to his iPad. And of course, the central point being he has already agreed, and I think he has already in fact paid back the full amount incurred on this expense.
Douglas Ross.
Hamza Yousaf said it was an honest mistake. He's 50% right with that. And he also said he has no intention of getting into this. Well, I have no intention of letting the First Minister off with that argument, because this goes to the heart of his government and his actions, and also the impact this is having on people across Scotland. Because this morning it emerged that Michael Matheson had cancelled a government visit to Glasgow GP surgery. The Health Secretary has stopped doing his job because of this. So this really matters when Scotland's NHS is in crisis and we're approaching winter. It matters if there was an attempt to dupe taxpayers out of £11,000. For nearly a year, Michael Matheson was happy for the taxpayer to pick up this bill. He made no attempt to repay it until he was caught. His story is farcical beyond belief. So I'm going to repeat my question to the First Minister. Can he guarantee that Michael Matheson ran up all of these costs on parliamentary business, yes or no?
First Minister.
Again, Michael Matheson will lay out in full detail what has happened. And Michael Matheson has already said, of course, last week.
First Minister. When a question has been put to the First Minister, I'm sure we all want to hear the response. We cannot hear the response when people are shouting from seats. First Minister.
The response is there is clearly more to it. Douglas Ross is absolutely right. What I won't do is preempt the personal statement that Michael Matheson has agreed with the Presiding Officer to make later this afternoon. He will lay out in full detail what has happened. But importantly, of course, when that mistake was not just made, when, of course, Michael Matheson was made aware of that mistake, he took corrective action. That corrective action was, of course, to repay the full amount. Where I disagree entirely with Douglas Ross is that Michael Matheson has been doing anything other than concentrating on the job at hand. That's why he was able to announce, and we were able to announce this morning, of course, that we've secured the future of Community Links workers posts in Glasgow with an additional investment of £1.2 million. On top of that, of course, this is the Health Secretary that ensured that Scotland was the country where there was not junior doctor strikes. On top of that, this is the Health Secretary who secured annual funding of £100 million to help to reduce waiting lists. So Michael Matheson is absolutely concentrating on the job at hand, but of course he will lay out in full later this afternoon the full detail of what has happened in relation to his parliamentary iPad.
Douglas Ross.
The Health Secretary is not doing his job. We know he refused to comment on shocking A&E waiting times this week because he was worried about the questions over his personal conduct. So yes, we need to hear from the Health Secretary, but this now goes beyond his actions. The First Minister has put his own personal reputation on the line. When this story broke, Hamza Yousaf said the £11,000 bill was a legitimate expense. He said the money didn't need to be repaid to the taxpayer. He called Michael Matheson a person of integrity and character. He said, and I quote, "I absolutely take Michael at his word." He gave him his 100% backing. The First Minister is claiming Michael Matheson's word is more important than the facts. But Hamza Yousaf's integrity is at stake here. So a direct question to the First Minister that he can't just put on the statement this afternoon. Does the First Minister still believe, as he did last week, even now with all the evidence, that this £11,000 bill was a legitimate expense?
First Minister.
First of all, Presiding Officer, to get a lecture on principles and integrity from the party that gave us Boris Johnson is quite something. In the week when Douglas Ross's party, their flagship policy in Rwanda, was torn to pieces by the Supreme Court.
First Minister, it's absolutely impossible to hear any question or response being put at the moment because there is far too much noise coming from members, and I will ask you to desist. First Minister.
As I said, Presiding Officer, it is clear that there is more that has been discovered in relation to the iPad and the expense. Michael Matheson will make that clear in a statement later on this afternoon. And of course, I do have absolute confidence in Michael Matheson as the Cabinet Secretary for Health. And let me tell you why. Because on top of ensuring that we resolve the issue around Community Links workers posts in Glasgow, on top of ensuring that we resolve the junior doctor strike.
First Minister, I'm going to ask you, Mr Hoy, to make sure that that is the last remark that I hear when you are not on your feet and you haven't been called to speak. First Minister.
Well, they don't want to hear it because, of course, it goes contrary to their claims, because Michael Matheson is also the Health Secretary that announced £15.6 million additional funding for hospital at home this year to deal with winter pressures. He's the Health Secretary that announced £50 million for funding for the Scottish Ambulance Service. That is a Health Secretary that is entirely focused on ensuring that NHS recovers through the course of what will be one of the most difficult winters. And as I say, Presiding Officer, Michael Matheson, upon discovering what is an honest mistake, of course paid back the expense in its entirety.
Douglas Ross.
It wasn't upon discovering something. He claimed this. He claimed £11,000 from the taxpayer. And all I have asked from Hamza Yousaf is, does he still agree, as he did last week, this was a legitimate expense, yes or no? And does he agree that that £11,000, that costs were ran up purely on parliamentary business, yes or no? I've tried that three times, and three times I have not had an answer. And the fact is, the First Minister should have immediately launched an investigation into this matter. He should have demanded that Michael Matheson hand over the device to be examined. Instead, he's the last person in Scotland still believing his Health Secretary's ridiculous claim. Now, if this story changes to be about family or personal usage, that still won't cut it, because it will be nearly a year after the claim and a week into this scandal. The evidence shows that Michael Matheson claimed £11,000 of taxpayers' money when he knew it wasn't for parliamentary work. It wasn't just a mistake, it was dishonest. So will Hamza Yousaf do the right thing and sack Michael Matheson or wait for his resignation?
First Minister.
As I have already demonstrated in my responses to Douglas Ross, Michael Matheson has been concentrating on ensuring that our NHS recovers through the course of what will be one of the most challenging winters it has faced. That's evidenced by the fact that I know over the last few weeks he's been working diligently to ensure that we are able to fund Community Links workers' posts in Glasgow. And I'm pleased we've been able to get to a resolution on that very matter. This, of course, is a matter between Michael Matheson as an MSP and indeed the parliamentary authorities. And, of course, the Parliament have made it clear that they have investigated the matter. But I have actually answered Douglas Ross's question.
Mr Ross.
Time.
Mr Ross. Excuse me, First Minister. The First Minister is answering questions. Mr Ross. You have had an opportunity to put questions to the First Minister. It's extremely important that we carry out our business in an orderly fashion and show one another courtesy and respect. First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I have answered, of course, Douglas Ross's question, which is that there is clearly more that has come to light, which Michael Matheson will make clear in just a couple of hours' time. That is why he took the decision to repay back the full amount of this expense. So he will lay that out. Michael Matheson will lay that out later this afternoon. What Michael Matheson will then continue to do, of course, is what he has been doing for weeks, for months now, which is ensuring that our NHS gets all the support it needs during one of the most difficult periods in its history.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
While the Health Secretary fights to save his job, the crisis in the NHS continues. Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board have been named as a suspect in a corporate homicide investigation into the deaths of four patients, including 10-year-old Millie Main. For years, Millie's family have sought justice. But years on from this case first being raised, no one has been held to account and no one has lost their job. The Chair, John Brown, who has overseen this scandal, comes to an end of his term in a few weeks. But despite being Chair of the only public body in Scottish history to be named a suspect in a corporate homicide case, he is to be kept on by the government as an advisor on NHS good governance. An advisor on NHS good governance. You couldn't make this up. First Minister, what message does this send to grieving families, and what does it say about your judgment that the man who presided over this scandal will continue to advise your government?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, first of all, my thoughts and my condolences continue to go to the families that have been impacted and affected. And let me pay credit to Anna Sarwar, who has provided, I know, support to many of those families who have been so tragically impacted and affected. Where Anna Sarwar and I will vehemently disagree is that, of course, the government, I believe, has, of course, taken action. That is why we established the public inquiry in the very first place. The entire purpose, the entire point of a public inquiry is to get to the truth of these matters. I can't obviously comment on a live police investigation. It is important for me to say that, of course, individuals haven't been named in relation to the Health Board. In that regard, it is the Health Board, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, that has, as a corporate entity, been named as a suspect. And I would say to Anna Sarwar, he may wish to be the judge and the jury in the investigation. It is my job to ensure that I don't interfere, that I don't intervene, neither in the public inquiry or indeed interfere in a live police investigation. So we will hold to the board to account when necessary. That's why, of course, the Oversight Board was established in the first place. And that's why we ensured that the 108 recommendations were completed. So we'll allow the independent inquiry and the independent police investigation get on with the job that they're meant to do without the government interfering.
Anna Sarwar.
You see, the First Minister's judgment is called into question here because Jean Freeman put these people into special measures and Hamza Yousaf lifted them out of special measures and empowered them. So let me be clear, John Brown shouldn't be advising this government and he should not hold any public appointments while the criminal investigation and the public inquiry continues. And the Chief Executive of this Health Board, Jane Grant, has been in post since before Millie died. During that time, she's been paid over £1 million. She has led an organisation that is now being investigated for corporate homicide, that has gaslit grieving families, shut down and bullied NHS staff, and called into question the results of an independent review that exposed fatal infections in children. Now she will continue to run this health board while the police investigate her actions and those of the people who report to her. In any other walk of life, suspects would not be allowed to walk free on a crime scene. So why does the First Minister continue to back and not sack the Chief Executive of this Health Board?
First Minister.
Can we just be absolutely clear on this? Anasawa has other information that is not in the public domain. Individuals such as Jane Grant have not been themselves named as a suspect. It is, of course, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde as a corporate entity, of course, that has been named as a suspect. And it is a suspect. It is important that the police investigation is allowed to continue. As I say, Anasawa may wish in his position to be judge and jury. It is important that I allow the police investigation to happen without interruption. Anasawa makes the point to me that the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde were de-escalated. He's right, they were de-escalated. But the entire point is they were de-escalated because they made improvements in performance following the completion of all 108 recommendations outlined in the independent review. Is Anasawa seriously suggesting that having completed all of the recommendations in that oversight board, that no appropriate action then should have been taken? In relation to patient safety, which is at the very heart of these issues, I'm very pleased that this Parliament was able to pass the Patient Safety Commissioner Bill. On top of that, of course, we have taken many actions in relation to patient safety. So I will continue to ensure that we allow the public inquiry, allow the police investigation to take its course unimpeded without interference from the Scottish Government, and at the same time, of course, do everything we can to ensure patient safety within our NHS.
It's such a tragedy that every week the First Minister just continues to demonstrate how completely out of depth he is in terms of his position. The first ever corporate homicide investigation of a public body in Scottish history, and these are the answers we are getting from Scotland's First Minister. Deadly mistakes made, facts denied, a cover-up continuing, and to this day, no one, not a single person, held to account. Instead, incompetence is rewarded. This is not just the story of this health board, but of this SNP government. From deleted WhatsApp COVID messages to the leadership of this health board being allowed to continue in their jobs, also this government can try and save face while families grieve the loss of loved ones. First Minister, your choices have consequences. This is what Kimberly Darrick, the mother of Millie Main, said on Monday. I've never been able to celebrate Millie's life like I should be. Anytime I think of Millie, I think of all the pain that day caused and continues to cause. I feel that pain the day I lost her every single day because of all of this. First Minister, for once, do the right thing. Sack the leadership of this health board.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I can't imagine the pain of losing a child. I think it is every parent's worst nightmare, without a shadow of a doubt. And I have, of course, paid credit to those who have supported Kimberly Darrick and other families who have suffered such a loss. What I am interested in is action. That's why this government established the Oversight Board. That's why we established the public inquiry. That's why we introduced and passed the Patient Safety Commissioner Bill. That's why we introduced the duty of candour. That's why we established the Independent National Whistleblowers Office, the first of its kind in the UK. That's why we ensured that there are whistleblowing champions in every single health board. We will continue to demonstrate that leadership. And I know Anasawa, he's always faltering when he goes for the personal attacks at something he has done throughout his entire period as leader of the Scottish Labour Party. Can I remind him about his version of leadership? I think we've seen just yesterday a demonstration of the lack of leadership that Anasawa is able to show. If in the face of thousands of innocent men, women and children in Gaza being killed, that Anasawa can't even demand that his own Labour MPs back a ceasefire, then that's not a version of leadership, Presiding Officer, that I will subscribe to.
Question number three, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
Tuesday.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I have here a Freedom of Information request which shows that the Fire Service contacted the Scottish Government 4 years ago about having to prop up station ceilings because of dangerous concrete. RAC is in 14 of them, from Mulgay to Portree. The Chief Fire Officer asked for £70 million to fix it, but ministers actually cut their capital budget in real terms. fire station roofs were the canary in the coal mine for the concrete crisis now affecting schools and hospitals. And yet, the government were nowhere on this, not telling Parliament, ignoring it internally, even cutting budgets. Firefighters run towards danger on every job, presiding officer. They shouldn't have to face it when they return to base. So can I ask the First Minister, would the government have ignored dangerous concrete for 4 years if it was found in the ceiling of Bute House?
First Minister.
Can I say to Alex Cole Hamilton, of course, what we have been doing and have, and many of our public bodies, local authorities have been doing, of course, is following the guidance of the Institute of Structural Engineers. It's really important that we continue to align ourselves with that important guidance. And of course, where RAC has been found, in the vast overwhelming majority of cases, my understanding that appropriate mitigations have been put in place. I did have a meeting just yesterday with the Scottish Trade Unions Congress, and the FBU represented at that meeting. They made a passionate plea in relation to the budgetary position that they are in, both in terms of the capital and resource, and RAC was mentioned in those discussions. So I will, of course, give those calls absolute consideration, as will the Deputy First Minister, when we are working up the budget next month. What I will say to Alex Cole Hamilton is this government has taken extensive measures and action alongside our partners in local government and other public bodies in relation to the RAC issue. And I'm happy that the government will provide Alex Cole Hamilton with a written response with all of the detail of the actions we've taken.
Question number four, Stephanie Callaghan.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. Oh, I'm sorry. To ask the First Minister what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the impact of the low emission zone in Glasgow.
First Minister.
The Scottish Government remains committed to tackling air pollution through the introduction of low emission zones in Aberdeen and Dundee and Edinburgh and indeed in Glasgow. We already know that many drivers have taken action to prepare for LEZs following our awareness raising campaigns. In addition, we've provided substantial funding to reduce emissions from midlife buses and taxis and supported those who are most in need of assistance to switch to less polluting and sustainable means of travel. Over £10 million has been provided through the LEZ Support Fund since 2019, resulting in almost 3,000 non-compliant vehicles being disposed of or retrofitted with cleaner technology. It's too early to comment on the impact on air pollution since LEZ enforcement commenced on the 1st of June 2023. This is because the data needs to be collected over an appropriate period and analysed. However, we do look forward to receiving the statutory LEZ reports and air quality data from Glasgow City Council in due course.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the First Minister for that answer, and it is really encouraging that the most recent figures show a drop in the number of fines issued in Glasgow's low emission zone, an indication that public awareness is growing. So can I ask the First Minister what interactions are taking place between the Scottish Government and other councils across Scotland who are looking to implement similar LEZ schemes as we work together to move towards a cleaner, greener and healthier transport system?
First Minister.
Well, I was pleased to see that the number of PCNs being issued falling month on month since July. I believe this shows the intended deterrent effect of increasing surcharges for subsequent contraventions of the LEZs is working. I'm very pleased that, of course, progress is being made in relation to the other cities' low-emission zones. And we know, of course, that when it comes to the challenges of air pollution right across Scotland, that these measures are increasingly important. We know that enforcement of the LEZs will commence on the 30th of May 2024 in Dundee, the 1st of June 2024 in Aberdeen, and indeed in Edinburgh. So it's important that in the face of a climate crisis that we can all see in front of us almost every single day, that we do everything we possibly can to mitigate that climate crisis, but also, of course, importantly for low emission zones, they are an important public health measure, particularly in some of our most polluted urban areas.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, I can tell the First Minister that at least 150 motorists are being wrongly issued fines every month for driving through Glasgow's low-emission zone. And Glasgow City Council says it doesn't know what to do with the colossal sums, £500,000 so far, that it's raising. Shouldn't they have sorted this out before introducing this botched scheme?
First Minister.
There's hardly a surprise that every time, of course, this government, or indeed local government, brings forward any even small or mild measure in order to tackle the climate crisis, it is opposed by the Conservatives time and time and time again, Presiding Officer. And let's also be absolutely clear that when it comes to all revenue above that incurred in running the LEZ scheme itself, can only be used for activities that help to reduce air pollution or contribute towards achieving our climate change targets. So I know that Glasgow will be thinking about what, where it can spend that money in order to help to reduce air pollution or indeed meet its own climate change targets. But I do say to Graeme Simpson and the Conservatives, they cannot continue to be climate deniers. They have to get with the mainstream and indeed support anybody, be it national government, be it local government, in order to tackle the dangers of the climate crisis.
Holly McNeill.
The city of Glasgow desperately needs people to return to the nighttime economy as the most locked-down city in the UK, and taxis are key to ensuring that people have confidence they will be able to get home, but taxi drivers have had to fight for every concession to help them comply with the LEZ zone, and taxi drivers tell me there's only one garage that will help them comply, and the waiting list is as long as 2026, but they only have a year to comply. Given, as the First Minister said, that other cities will face these challenges, will the First Minister look into a national grant scheme, and what else can be done to help the taxi trade comply, and given that Scotland's largest city needs to come out of the pandemic in recovery? I think this is very much important to deal with.
First Minister.
This is an important issue, of course. We all value the nighttime economy and, of course, the important role that taxi drivers play in that regard. It is important to note that it isn't necessary to purchase a new taxi or an electric taxi to be LEZ compliant for taxi operators who do wish to change their vehicle. Some older taxis may be suitable for that retrofitting, but I take the point that Polly McNeill makes. If there is only one garage, as she has described, and there are extremely long waiting lists, then I will ensure that we liaise with Glasgow City Council to see what support we can provide. It should be said that the LEZ Support Fund has been providing grant funding for taxi retrofits since 2019, and since it opened, over 300 taxis have taken up the funding for retrofitting. So there is a fund available, but I do take the points that Polly McNeill raises very seriously indeed, and we will explore and examine with our partners in Glasgow City Council if there's more that we can do.
Question number five, Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the First Minister whether he will provide an update on when the Scottish Government will review its ban on alcohol consumption on ScotRail train services.
First Minister.
Firstly, I should acknowledge that there are quite a wide range of views on this very issue. My priority is ensuring that ScotRail services are safe, are enjoyable for all users and staff, but specifically women and girls, where we know of the role that alcohol often plays in making women feel unsafe. That's why the Transport Minister has asked that officials at Transport Scotland engage with the British Transport Police, ScotRail, ScotRail Holdings, Transport Focus, amongst other organisations, to ensure that all views on continuing the alcohol ban on ScotRail trains are given due consideration and all impacts are indeed assessed. That following a meeting last month, we've also written to trade union leaders asking for their views on the issue. We will, of course, update Parliament in the most appropriate way when a decision has been made and once we take into account all the views of stakeholders.
Douglas Lumsden.
First Minister, it's now 3 years since alcohol was banned on ScotRail trains as a COVID precaution measure. ScotRail and British Transport Police have both told me the ban is unworkable. People who indulge in antisocial behaviour are ignoring the ban and drinking anyway. It's the law-abiding Scots who are being penalised. So, First Minister, is it not time the SNP showed some trust in the Scottish public and scrapped this draconian rule and get more people back on the trains, especially during the upcoming Christmas period?
First Minister.
A couple of things I would say to Douglas Lumsden, as I do appreciate there's a wide variety of views on this, and that's exactly why the Transport Minister has asked for a whole variety of stakeholders to be engaged. I've mentioned some of those stakeholders already in terms of British Transport Police, Transport Scotland, ScotRail, trade unions and others. And I would say to Douglas Lumsden, we will give appropriate weight to those stakeholders. He, I'm sure, will not dispute that we'll give particular weight to the voices of women and girls, who often are the ones who tell us that they can feel unsafe when it comes to antisocial behaviour. I have to say to Douglas Lumsden, I don't have an absolute fixed view in terms of the evidence that will be brought forward. If, of course, the evidence points towards that ban being lifted, then, of course, we will explore that and give that appropriate consideration.
John Mason.
Thank you. While the ban is in place, and of course there's other antisocial behaviour as well as drinking alcohol, can the First Minister say anything about the enforcement of it? And particularly, I do understand that some staff are getting body-worn cameras, and is there any evidence of the effectiveness of these?
First Minister.
Well, the use of body-worn cameras is an operational matter for ScotRail, but I think it's important to clarify here that staff are not expected to enforce the alcohol ban on ScotRail trains. The enforcement of the alcohol ban is a matter for British Transport Police. The expansion of body-worn camera provision for staff through the rollout of 900 new cameras across ScotRail is part of a £1.6 million investment in tackling antisocial behaviour on the rail network. It is not specifically targeted at the consumption of alcohol in ScotRail services. It's part of that wider effort right across the railways to make staff safer while carrying out their duties and improve the experiences of the travelling public. However, we know that research indicates that body-worn cameras can positively influence customer behaviour and reduce a wide range of antisocial behaviours. And I'm sure ScotRail will continue to update Transport Scotland and the Transport Minister on the matter.
Question number six, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the First Minister what immediate action the Scottish Government is taking to address the reported crisis in social care in light of the letter from the Coalition of Care and Support Providers in Scotland stating that the social care pay uplift is insufficient.
First Minister.
Well, I do place a huge value on our social care workforce and exceptional care that they do provide. I'm fully committed to improving their pay to reflect that. The £12 minimum pay rate from April 2024 represents an increase of over 10% from the £10.90 minimum rate that was introduced in April of this year. It's also a 14.3% increase for these workers over the last 2 years. For workers in children's services who previously received the national minimum wage, this increase will represent a minimum increase in pay of 15.2% compared to April 2023 levels. So we're doing all we can within the devolved responsibilities and budgets to address those cost of living pressures. However, as a result of 13 years of Tory austerity, there's never been greater pressure on our public finances. If only we had those full powers over our budget, then we would not have to be at the whim of an austerity-driven UK government.
Jackie Bailey.
I'm pleased to hear how much the First Minister values social care, because he will also know that vacancies for social care staff are up, turnover is up, some providers are handing back contracts because they're unable to deliver quality care due to a lack of staff. The First Minister announced that social care pay would rise to £12 from April 2024. That is now the uprated rate for the real living wage, so any advantage has been eroded. Does the First Minister believe that social care staff deserve the bare minimum in pay? And if not, will he bring forward revised proposals in the budget to properly value our hard-working social care staff?
First Minister.
We do value our hard-working social care staff. That's why, of course, we have agreed to increase the pay of over 10% from the £10.90 minimum rate that was introduced in April of this year. And I completely accept, fully accept, because I have engaged with the social care workforce, that they want us to go further and they want us to go faster. I completely respect that and understand that. We are, of course, constrained by our budget. And, of course, I will remind Jackie Bailey that it was Anas Sawar, her colleague, who said that he was completely, I think, had a presumption against income tax rises. So we have a position here where Jackie Bailey seems to be asking us to increase significantly the pay of social care workers. Those £15 to £15 an hour, that would cost the government an additional £1.2 billion. So on the one hand, Jackie Bailey and Scottish Labour Party are saying you cannot raise revenue in any way, shape or form. But at the same time, you have to find £1.2 billion to increase the pay to £15 an hour. So we will engage with the Scottish Labour Party. We are in the run-up, of course, to the budget. What I would say to Jackie Bailey, if she's asking us to spend in the order of £1.2 billion, if she has any credibility whatsoever, she has to tell us where we'll find that money from.
We move to constituency and general supplementaries, and I call Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last Friday, technical faults meant that both ferries to Arran, Ardrossan to Brodick and Lochranz to Clunig, were off, with cancellations continuing into the Saturday. First Minister, given the continued impact of ferry disruption, what economic assistance will the Scottish Government consider to enable businesses on Arran to survive what is already proving to be a very challenging winter?
First Minister.
Can I thank Ken Gibson for the question, for his invitation for me to come to Arran to speak with businesses and the community earlier this year. And I do absolutely recognise, having had those conversations, the severe impact that disruption has regrettably had. And the best thing we can do is ensure, for CalMac, to ensure that disruption does not happen. That's why this government is absolutely committed to investing in our ferry services and delivering 6 new major vessels to Scotland's ferry network by 2026. The charter of the MV Alfred is a further example of this, and CalMac were able to redeploy her last weekend to pick up services on the Ardrossan-Brodick route. That being said, in my visit to Arran, I heard very clearly from the community that they wanted a better level of engagement with CalMac, and I will ensure that the Transport Minister provides Kenneth Gibson with some of the updates on how that conversation has been going.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It had been reported today that the processing times for child disability payment have risen to over 100 days. This represents just the latest failure of Social Security Scotland to deliver for those in need. Does the First Minister believe that those shocking delays embody dignity, fairness and respect?
First Minister.
I do understand that an invitation has been given to Jeremy Balfour to visit the agency if he wishes. I don't know if it's been taken up, but the invitation still remains for him to visit the agency, and they will be able to talk him through the numerous actions that they are taking to reduce those processing times. Because I don't disagree with Jeremy Balfour. Processing times are far longer than we would want them to be, and the Cabinet Secretary and I have spoken in great length and great detail about the number of actions that are being taken by the agency. In fact, I'll ensure that she responds to Jeremy Balfour with the full detail of the actions that are being taken. What is positive out of some of the statistics that we have seen most recently is that when it comes to many of our benefits, the redetermination rate is much lower here in Scotland than it is, for example, in comparison to the UK. So it may take slightly longer to process, I accept that point, but it's really important that we get the right decision the first time around in as many cases as we possibly can. But I will ensure that Jeremy Balfour gets a full update from the Cabinet Secretary in terms of the actions we're taking.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister will know that BT confirmed yesterday the closure of their Alness base. 100 jobs will be lost, impacting in 1 in 50 local residents in Alness. Can I ask what talks he has had with BT to prevent these jobs losses, given that the BT Group have benefited and enjoyed hundreds of millions of pounds of government funding?
First Minister.
Well, I'm sure that the Cabinet Secretary does engage with Rhoda Grant directly in terms of what support we're able to provide. Of course, these are extremely difficult times for the staff group that are involved. We don't want to see job losses. We'll do everything we can to try to prevent job losses. And where, if it is necessary, if those job losses look like they are going to occur, then we can, of course, engage pace, where we can insist with, of course, redeployment where we possibly can. But we want to try to see if we can avoid the situation of the 100 job losses that Rhoda Grant mentions. And I'll ensure that post-FMQs that the Cabinet Secretary engages with Rhoda Grant directly.
Ross Greer.
Thank you. The First Minister has shown a moral leadership completely lacking at Westminster with his calls for ceasefire in Gaza. And while the focus is rightly on trying to stop the slaughter happening there, over 180 Palestinians have been killed by extremist Israeli settlers and soldiers in the West Bank, and 1,000 have been forced to flee their villages. The United Nations has identified 97 companies who are complicit in Israel's illegal occupation through its West Bank settlements. The Scottish Government rightly takes a very strong stance against support for any company still trading with Russia after its invasion of Ukraine. So will the First Minister confirm that any company complicit in illegal occupation, whether it be of Palestine or of Ukraine, must be banned from receiving public sector contracts or grants here in Scotland?
First Minister.
I can thank Ross Greer for his question. And it is worth reiterating here that I think it is also the position of the UK Government that settlements
are indeed illegal, and it's an international, most of the international community agree with that point. And let me mention the point, the action that the former Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, Ivan McKee, took. He wrote to a small number of companies on a UN list that had links to the government or public bodies, asking what steps they were taking in relation to any of those companies that were working in legal settlements. My understanding is that we are somewhat constrained in terms of what we can do within the devolved settlement, but let me be very clear to Ross Grier. We will examine what we're able to do. Anybody who's profiteering from illegal settlements anywhere, of course, including in the occupied territories, wherever they are, they should not be able to profit from public contracts here. So let's explore what is possible within the limitations of devolution, and I join with Ross Grier and with many others across this chamber in urging the international community to get right behind a ceasefire, and of course a ceasefire now.
Keith Brown.
Our approach to migration and refugees should have dignity, fairness and respect at its core, as opposed to the UK Government's hostile environment approach, which we currently have to endure. Yesterday, the UK Government's plan to send asylum seekers to Rwanda was ruled illegal by the Supreme Court. Can the First Minister provide any information on any assessment of these plans by the Scottish Government? Can he also confirm that more than £140 million of taxpayers' money, including Scottish taxpayers' money, has been squandered on this illegal scheme? And can he confirm whether he has heard a single word of criticism from any Tory MSP on this huge waste of taxpayers' money on this unworkable, scandalous and illegal scheme?
First Minister, on matters for which the government has responsibility.
All I heard, I'm afraid, is when Keith Brown was speaking, a whole bunch of groans from Tory MSPs as he mentioned, of course, the need for a humane asylum system here in the UK. And that's exactly what we need. We need a humane system that doesn't leave asylum seekers stuck in destitution for years without the right to work. And we recently launched our paper on migration in an independent Scotland, which sets out our approach to migration based very much in the values of dignity, of fairness and respect. Migrants who come to this country, they contribute more than they take. They bring skills, they bring experience, which greatly benefits our economy and enhances the diversity of our society. The UK government's policy of sending asylum seekers to Rwanda is morally repugnant. It's now been confirmed as unlawful too. This policy should be consigned to the dustbin of history and have no place in a modern and humane society.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's now been almost 8 weeks since I raised the issue of the fire at the Air Station Hotel in the Chamber. The station is still closed, the surrounding roads are closed due to safety concerns, and local businesses are suffering. So can I ask the First Minister again, what funding and help can the Scottish Government provide to help find a speedy resolution?
First Minister.
And I thank Sharon Dowie for raising what is an important issue. And of course, all of our hearts go with those communities that have been affected by the disruption due to the Air Station Hotel fire. I will ensure that a written update is provided to Sharon Dowie in terms of the actions that we have taken alongside our partners in Ayrshire. And I want to commend once again our brave firefighters and Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, who once again, of course, diligently, efficiently dealt with that tragic fire at Air Station Hotel. But I will ensure that Sharon Dowie gets full details of our interactions with the local authority and the support we are able to provide.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This morning, the IFS published a report that shows children in Scotland are falling behind in science and maths, and that the gap between the test scores of the richest and poorest children has grown. Yesterday, head teachers were the latest group to join a chorus of experts to say this government's inaction on reform is hurting the poorest students. So can I ask the First Minister, does he accept that with every day that passes and his government dither on the key decisions needed on reform, he is denying Scotland's children the opportunities they deserve?
First Minister.
No, I don't agree with that characterisation at all. And of course, it is the poverty-related attainment gap that we are, of course, committed to substantially eliminating. And what I would say to Pam Duncan-Glancy, that is made far more difficult by a Westminster government that is hell-bent on deepening poverty at every single stage. What I would say to Pam Duncan-Glancy is we are indeed making progress when it comes to reducing and narrowing the poverty related attainment gap. If you look at the recent Audit Scotland report, if you look at exam results show that between attainment levels in the least and most deprived areas, it has narrowed from the 2019 level, the pre-pandemic level. And I can again send full detail to Pam Duncan-Glancy of the narrowing of that gap and the progress that we're making. But we are absolutely committed to making sure that we continue to narrow that gap. That job would be made far easier, of course, if we weren't having the headwinds of austerity that the Westminster Government have inflicted on the people of Scotland.
And Ivan McKee.
Community Link practitioners play a vital role in GP surgeries, including in my own Glasgow Provan constituency. So it's very welcome that the Health Secretary has confirmed that the Scottish Government will be providing additional funding over 3 years to help preserve the existing Community Link worker programme within Glasgow City Health and Social Care Partnership. Can the First Minister provide any further information about this funding and how it will be directed to continue to deliver positive health outcomes in communities?
First Minister.
Well, I agree entirely with Ivan McKee's sentiments. Community Link workers are absolutely vital to the communities they serve, and every single one of us as MSPs who has had the pleasure of interacting with Community Link workers know just how much they're valued, not just by the communities, but indeed by the GP practices that they serve in. And they're at the forefront of our efforts to address health inequalities. Since we learnt of the risk to these vital services, we've engaged extensively, and Michael Matheson has engaged extensively over several months with Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership to find a solution. And I'm therefore pleased to confirm that we will be able to provide the partnership with £1.2 million to sustain the full provision of Community Link workers. And as Ivan McKee rightly says, we've offered that funding on a recurrent basis for the next 3 years. As I've said, they are Community Links workers are absolutely fundamental, vital to tackle the inequality that we see to rife in our communities that has been exacerbated by the Westminster cost of living crisis. And I hope the decision to fund them for the next 3 years brings peace of mind, not just to the staff whose posts were at risk, but most importantly for the communities that they serve.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. Point of order, Liam Kerr.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. This week, the Scottish Government finally accepted that its claim that Scotland had 25% of Europe's offshore wind potential was wholly wrong. The correct figure is 6 to 7%. Angus Robertson may wish to wait for this moment, incidentally, as he walks out. Angus Robertson was officially advised to stop using the misleading figure on the 28th September 2022, but continued to state it as truth until at least the 18th of October 2022, including in meetings with foreign governments. Presiding Officer, members across this chamber have raised repeated concerns that this was a breach of the ministerial code. Now, the former First Minister swept this under the carpet. So what powers do you have as Presiding Officer to compel this First Minister to ask the independent adviser on the ministerial code to establish if knowingly giving false statistics to foreign governments is a breach of that code?
Thank Mr Kerr for his point of order on a matter which he has raised previously and I have addressed previously. And as members are aware, the accuracy of members' contributions, the accuracy is not a matter for the chair to rule on. It is not something which is covered by standing orders. But of course, as a matter of courtesy and respect, I would expect all members always to be accurate in their contributions. And the Scottish Ministerial Code also states that it's of paramount importance that ministers give accurate and truthful information to the Parliament and that any inadvertent errors are corrected at the earliest opportunity. Mr. Stephen Kerr.
Presiding Officer, about 2 minutes, 3 minutes ago, an email arrived telling us that there will be a personal statement from Michael Matheson at 2 o'clock. I think we in this chamber and also the watching Scottish public might want to know whether we will be able to ask questions of Michael Matheson once he has delivered his statement. If he is not going to be subject to questions, I think the people of Scotland will wonder exactly what's going on in this Parliament.
Thank Mr Kerr for his point of order. And I would just say to Mr Kerr that standing orders make it quite clear that personal statements are not debated. That concludes First Minister's questions, and we move on to the next item of business. And at this point, I'll suspend business to enable the gallery and the chamber to clear. Thank you.